Job had a story to tell. Verse 1 said, there was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. And that man was perfect and upright, and one that feared God and eschewed evil, which means he stayed away from evil. Then he goes on to talk about the wealth of Job and the things he had. And verse 6 picks up and says, now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord. And Satan came also among them. And the Lord said unto Satan, whence comest thou?
Yes, sir.
What I like about it is when God talks, even the devil has answers.
Yes.
Right there in the text. Then Satan answered the Lord and said, from going to and fro in the earth, walking up and down in it.
Yes.
And the Lord said unto Satan, hast thou considered my servant? And I don't want to put a name in there because he may be considering you or me right now. God may have asked Satan to consider you, but only if you his servant. That there is none like him. Boy, what a testimony for God to have about you this morning. There's none like him in the earth. A perfect and upright man. What a testimony from God. One that feareth God and escheweth evil. Then Satan answered the Lord and said, do Job fear God for naught? Hast thou not made a hedge about him and about his house and about all that he hath on every side? Thou hast blessed the work of his hands, and the substance is increased in the land. But put forth thy hand now, and touch all that he hath, and he will curse thee to thy face. And the Lord said unto Satan, behold, all that he hath is in thy power. Somebody need to know the reason things are going the way they are. Is God just showing you where you're going to be. It may be a little dark and desperate right now, but God already knows the end before the beginning. So Satan went forth from the presence of the Lord. I encourage you, don't follow Satan. Don't leave out of the presence of the Lord. It's all right here in the text. I'm just reading a little bit. I'm not going to bother. And there was a day when the sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in the eldest brother's house. And there came a messenger unto Job and said, the oxen were plowing and the asses feeding it beside them. And the Sabians fell upon them and took them away. They have slain the servants with the edge of a sword. And I only have escaped alone to tell thee. God's always going to let somebody come to bring you some bad news. While I was yet speaking, there came also another and said, fire from God is fallen from the heaven and hath burned up all the sheep and the servants, consumed them, and I only am escaped alone to tell thee. Somebody say, I know. While he was yet speaking, there came also another and said, the Chaldeans made out three bands and fell upon the camels and have carried them away, yea, and slain the servants with the edge of the sword, and I only am escaped. You don't even know when to shout. Alone to tell thee. He was yet speaking, there came also another and said, here's the problem. The tension is mounting in the text. Thy sons and thy daughters were eating and drinking wine in thy eldest brother's house. And behold, there came a great wind from the wilderness and smote the four corners of the house. And it fell upon the young men, and they are dead. Here's the shout in the text again. And I only am escaped alone to tell thee. Then Job arose and rent his mantle. He tore his clothes, shaved his head, fell down on the ground and worshiped. Hey, sometimes I gotta get stuff out the way. I gotta tear my clothes, shave my head, fall down and worship. You missed what I said. Sometimes there's some stuff that keeps me from worshiping God. But even in the midst of the trouble, in the midst of trials, are you willing to get stuff out the way? Tear your clothes, shave your head, fall down upon the ground and worship Him. I wish somebody else was giving God some praise in here. Because it's not that bad for you. You ain't went through that much. Okay, I'm done. Watch the text and I'm gonna sit down. And say it. See, somebody should be and say it. Yeah, I tore my clothes. I shaved my head. I'm down on the ground. But I remember, naked came I out of my mother's womb. And naked shall I return. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken away. Nor charge God foolishly. If Thanksgiving is going to be real, it needs to start right now. I know you're going through some things. I know it's probably harder for you than it's ever been. But if Job can give up all that and still say, naked did I come into the world, and naked shall I, but blessed. I wish I had some help somewhere. You gotta worship your way out of where you're in right now. You gotta say, blessed. I know it's bad, but maybe it ain't gonna stay that way. Blessed. Somebody say, called us, Lord, and now qualify us. Give us permission and privilege to enter into your word, that we may preach a word that is fruitful for these, your people.
Yes, sir.
Fall fresh upon me, anoint me with fresh oil from heaven, that I may stand and proclaim the Christ.
Yes, sir.
The Christoph.
Yes.
Yes.
The anointed one.
Yes.
Use me to thy glory.
Use me, Lord.
We'll be careful to give your name the praise, the honor, and the glory.
Yes, sir.
It's Jesus' name we ask it all.
Amen.
We're going to ask you to turn with us to a familiar place in Scripture, to the 24th chapter of Matthew and the 14th verse, just one verse of Scripture. Matthew 24 and 14. Matthew 24 and verse 14, one verse of Scripture for this day. If you have it, say amen. If you'd be so kind as to stand to your feet to honor the Word of God as is read in your hearing. Matthean text in this pericope therefore states, and this gospel,
yes sir, yes,
and this gospel,
yes sir,
of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world,
yes sir,
for a witness unto all nations,
yes, yes,
and then shall the end come.
My Lord,
you may be seated.
Yes, sir.
And this gospel,
yes, yes,
of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world,
yes, sir,
for a witness unto all nations.
Yes,
and then shall the end come.
My Lord.
So, if we're going to get to Jesus,
yes,
and fulfill our quest,
yes, sir,
as we pilgrim through this barren land, and sojourn to our ultimate destination, if we are going to seriously seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, can I give some assistance this morning?
Yes.
So that it isn't just rhetoric or rhetorical statements, but it becomes real. 4 years ago, I went to Flint, Michigan in the month of November to visit my ailing father in the ministry. And he said to me, son, take care of this thing called life. And he didn't stop there. He said, and stay in the book. As I look at this most festive time of the year, and I began to wonder, what do I say to this church as we prepare to close this year, as we prepare to enter into one of the most festive times on the calendar? We have our Thanksgiving week, and then we move to the Christmas season, and then to a new year. Right in the midst of it will be an Advent season, a very, very personal time of reflection for Christians all over the world. What do I say in the backdrop of all of the tyranny and terrorist acts that are going on? What do I say in an America that is not sure what the identity of America is anymore? A nation that was once a Christian nation, but now has lost its identity. What do I say to this America? Even the church has lost its foundation and fundamental purposes of seeking the lost that they might be saved. Even the church house has lost its connection with the keeper of the church. The church house has lost its foundation and fundamental association with the Savior. What do I say to a church? As I began to think back on the time I spent with the Reverend Dr. F.O. Hockenhall, and I love to watch preaching during the weekend. As I was looking at some preachers, I found a preacher that my own Deacon Huntley is familiar with, the Reverend Dr. Herbert Lusk Jr. And I married these two men together to hear what God was saying to me to stand and say to you on this morning. And I thank God that he still communicates with me. Yes, as I began to think, how do we close this year? And I'm putting together a series of sermons, and it's just two words to the tag and to the text, and it's this gospel. If we look at the text, it says, and this gospel. Yes. I'm sure I'm right about it, because I asked Paul, and Paul showed me in the Corinthian text in 1 and 23, he says, but we preach Christ. Crucified unto the Jew a stumbling block, and unto the Greek foolishness. Notice I said this gospel, not this gossip, nor this garbage. We have to be able to separate and understand what is God saying to his church in this season. The text says that this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. I take the direct challenge and charge from this day, from the Lord Jesus Christ as my mandate, and from my earthly father in the ministry, F.O. Hockenhall, as earthly marching orders for this church as we prepare to close this year, as we wrestle against the things that attack each and every one of us on a day-to-day basis, how we have to fight our way through some things. We can't just settle anymore. We can't be a church and people at church anymore. The church has to be in the people. I've gotten wise enough to stop trying to get a lot of folk in church, because I need to get some church in folk. Some of you need to be brimming over from being full from being at church, and not just coming to church anymore. I know I have the ability to stand here and articulate with the best of. I've worked hard to get where I got. They didn't hand me anything. But what I want you to understand, I can pontificate it with ecumenical eruditions and proclivity of pedagogical approaches, and nobody would know what I was talking about. I can speak to the canons with grammatical clarity. I can proclaim through an exegiastic and exegesic sermonic proclification, but you would sit there wondering what I'm talking about. I have been around long enough that I understand the theology, the study of God, Christology, the study of the person and the work of Jesus Christ, pneumatology, which is the study of the person and the work of the Holy Spirit. See, I can get over your head and you couldn't get to me. I can talk about bibliology, which is the study of the Bible, soteriology, which is the study of salvation through Christ Jesus. I can talk about Christian anthropology, the study of the nature of humanity through the biblical transgression. I can talk about harmatology, the study of the nature of the effects of sin in the people. I can talk about angelology. I can talk about the study of angels. I can talk about Christian demonology, the study of demons and how they attack the people of God. I can talk about ecclesiology, the study of the nature and the mission of the church. I can talk about eschatology, the last days which we live in, but that's where the text is from. But I don't want to pontificate. I want to stop down and just talk about this gospel. I want to break it all down. I don't want to stand up here and try to take you somewhere you don't know if you should go or not. I want to keep it simple so we understand what's going on. I merely want to talk about this gospel. Yeah. I do realize that this gospel is offensive to some people. Paul asked the question in Romans, the 10th chapter, how shall they preach except they be sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. But look at what he says in verse 16. But they have not all obeyed this gospel. For Isaiah says, and that's just Isaiah, who has believed our report? I'm afraid that as I stand here today, that question is relevant to the church. Who has believed our report? Who has taken this thing serious? What thing, Pastor? This gospel.
Yes.
This gospel, which is necessary for us to move into the relationship we must have
in order to get out of the situations we're now in.
Yeah.
I look at the text, and Paul says in Galatians, the first chapter in verse 6, he says, I marvel that you are soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ, unto another gospel. He goes on to say, which is not another, but there are some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ.
Yes, sir.
You don't hear me.
Oh, yes.
Verse 8, he goes a little further. He said, but though we or an angel from heaven preach another gospel unto you, that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed.
Yes,
what he
sir.
Says is, let him be damned. Mm-hmm. What he's saying is, anybody preach a gospel that wasn't given by the first proclaimer of the gospel, whose life was the living gospel, he says, is no gospel. I wish you understood what I said. He said, if it doesn't depict the life of Jesus, it's no gospel.
Amen.
He says, there is not another gospel. There's no full gospel. It's just this gospel. And what he's trying to get us to understand, if we are going to be the people God has called us to be, if this life is ever going to be relevant, we must stand for this gospel. I wish somebody said amen.
Amen.
This is not a time you're going to shout, but I'm trying to inform you that this gospel is necessary for the people of God to do the things that he's called us to do.
Yes,
God is calling some people, and let me give it to you in the English Standard Version of Galatians 6, I mean 1, 6 through 10. I want you to go home and study this. Galatians, first chapter,
yes,
verses 6 through 10. The English Standard Version says, I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting him who called you into the grace of Christ and turning to a different gospel. Verse 7 in the English Standard Version says, not that there is another one, but there are some who trouble you. And they're like those callers who call anonymously just to worry you. And what they do is they just keep bombarding you, and pretty soon you surrender to them. And it said they want to distort the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to the one which he preached to you, and when they're talking about he, they're talking about Jesus. And Jesus preached through the proclamation and the demonstration. Somebody say demonstration.
Demonstration.
Your life should be a demonstration of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Nobody should have to hear a word you say. They should see how you live. Somebody know that the reason you are who you are is how you act. We have came to the agreement that our thoughts shape our behaviors,
yeah,
and that our behaviors shape our character,
yeah,
and then our character creates our culture. Some of us are living in bad situations because of your thinking. Your thinking got you locked in a bad culture. And if you want out, you got to use this gospel.
Amen.
He says, but even if we are an angel from heaven should preach to you a gospel contrary to the one that Jesus lived, let him be damned. As we have said before, so I say again, if anyone is preaching to you a gospel contrary to the one you received from Christ, let him be accursed. For I am seeking the approval of man. That he says, for am I seeking the approval of man or the approval of God? That's what it says in that 10th verse. Who are you trying to get to approve your behavior? Some of us just want folk to approve us. Some of us want people to pat us on the back. That's our energy to keep on going. When folk tell you, you like Forrest Gump, run! Forrest, run! And here we are running without a destination. But what he's saying here is time that we quit looking for folk to give you a pat on the back. And you should wait for God to give you a well done. He says, or
Am I trying to please man? If I were trying to please man, I would not be a servant of Christ Jesus. What he's saying is no man can serve two masters. For the Bible says he will love one and hate the other. God is wanting to know why are there so many haters at church. Because you have surrendered this gospel. I realize that there are some decisions that I must make. I realize being a board member for GRIP, Greater Richmond Interfaith Program, I have to carefully reassess that because it goes against this gospel. When we want to clump everything together, there's a problem. Muslim, Buddhist, Jehovah's Witness, Mormon. If they don't receive this gospel, in hell will they lift up their eyes? See, the problem is in your efforts to be politically correct. These interfaith meetings, I can't dialogue with them. I don't need to hear what they're saying. They need to hear the proclamation that this gospel said, that John said in the third chapter and the 16th verse, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believe on him should not perish. I can't go to interfaith meetings. Alive. I don't need Buddhists and a Shinto monk. I need Jesus. I don't have much to hear from them. I come to offer them Jesus. I'm sorry. This gospel is not for all faiths. This gospel pushes all faith into one. Ephesians 4 and 15 said, one Lord, one faith, and one baptism. I understand that somebody's getting nervous up in here because you're saying, Pastor, you're going to offend someone. But if this gospel is going to be preached, somebody's going to be offended up in here because this gospel is not that gospel, which is no gospel. I have people that say, I'm not going to Zion Hill because Pastor Anthony, a.k.a. Hodge, is preaching at me. Some people say, you hurt my feelings. Tell your neighbor, say, this gospel, if it's preached right, it's going to hurt somebody's feelings. This gospel, if it's preached right, a sissy don't get his feelings hurt. This gospel, if it's preached right, don't make a lesbian uncomfortable. This gospel, if it's preached right, don't make a liar sweat. This gospel, if it's preached right, don't make an adulterer. But a fornicator will be offended with this gospel. A thief will get offended, Reverend, with this gospel. Thief, a gossiper, will get offended with this gospel. A pastor hater will get offended with this gospel. But I'm sorry, he said, if you don't preach this gospel, you will be accursed. I did enough to myself that when I
stand to preach. I'm going to preach this gospel. This gospel will expose you to being a fan. I had some folk on yesterday. When Ohio State lost, they're just fans. Young man had a scholarship to Ohio State. They lost, he started talking about the coach. Said, I don't know why they didn't give me the ball. When this gospel is preached, some of y'all are gonna get mad at the coach because you didn't get the ball. You just a fan. I need followers. Followers show up even when the team lose. Fans just put on the colors when they win. Some folk come to Zion Hill. I realize you just a fan, but I need some folk that's gonna be followers. Folk that say, for God I live, for God I'll die. Some folk who show up even when they don't get the ball and they'll learn how to block. I need some folk that says, this gospel. There are some fans and they're on the sidelines, shouters, and they're not fit to get in the game. They just stand on the sideline and shout and criticize the folk that's in the game. But if you ain't never toted the ball, you don't know why I fumble sometimes. If you ain't never caught the ball, you don't know why I miss a few catches. But I'm glad that I need some folk in the game. I'm glad little Jose told me that the deacons are supposed to be the blockers. If you won't block, then you got to know the play, which means this gospel has to be part of your itinerary. If you're going to be a wide receiver and go out and catch a pass, you got to know what this gospel says. You can't run over and listen to that gospel. You got to know this gospel.
Yes, sir.
There are some of you are just at your until moment. Until you don't agree. Until I correct you. Until the load gets heavy. Until you get tired. Until I call you out. Until I don't let you have your way no more. You only with me until. Well, I stop by to tell you that some of the untils gotta get out of the way, because God is sending some in that's gonna be here in spite of. I don't need you to criticize me. I need you to stand and do what this Bible says. Somebody ought to hear me. I know that this gospel, we sing, we are soldiers in the army of the Lord, but we desert the church as soon as trouble shows up. That's why this gospel is an offense to those who have priority problems. This gospel said, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things he'll add on to you. I'm glad that I got some folk that want to ascribe to this gospel.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
But there are some of those who want everything their way.
Yes, sir.
They want a feel-good gospel.
Yes.
And I stop to tell you, that's not the gospel at all.
That's right.
Luke says in the gospel, if any man come to me and hate not his father and his mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. That's found in this gospel. I'm glad that I had a father in the ministry, like the late Reverend Dr. F.O. Hockenhall, who told me, stay in the book. As a matter of fact, the last message I heard him preach,
in Little Rock, Arkansas. He preached the word, preached the book, until the book opens itself up. What am I saying? Until God opens up the book to expose those whose names have been written in the Lamb's book of life. I'm going to preach this gospel.
Yes, sir. Amen.
Paul wanted Timothy to know. So in 2 Timothy 4:3, he says, I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing in his kingdom. Uh-huh. Preach the word. Be instant. In season. Yeah. Out of season. Yeah. Reprove. Uh-huh. That means make sure they're right. Yeah. Means check your test scores. Uh-huh. Yes, rebuke. That means tell you when you're wrong. That means correct the answers they got wrong and give the paper back to them. You don't like that part. We just like the exhortation, lifting up, but God says you don't need to be lifted up. In this gospel, he says, if I be lifted up, I'll draw all men unto me. I'm glad that he said, with all long suffering and doctrine, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heed themselves teachers having itching ears, and they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned to fables. That's the reason some of you like folk that tell you what you want to hear. We got a group of friends. We only call folk that stand in agreement with our foolishness. Folk that tell you, girl, you know you look good in that dress. You need to take that thing off. My grandfather said you look like a sack of nickels, sack of quarters in a nickel bell. Too many lumps and bumps. You need to be responsible. God says all things. He said we should be responsible for how we look. How you gonna lead folk to Christ and you looking like that? Men running around dying their hair, trying to put on toupee. If it's gone, baby, let it go. The next day is black. Make up your mind. My Bible says an unstable man, says a double-minded man is unstable. That's why you're unstable. You're double-minded. You don't know how to think right. Come to church like it's a fashion show. We don't need peacock. We need sheep. This gospel says beware. Before you turn away from me and cut me off, I just want to remind you this gospel. I don't want you leave believing this gospel will only offend folks, but this gospel will also offer. Somebody said, thank God for the offer. This gospel will offer the way out for a sinner. I'm glad that Jesus said in this gospel, I came not to call the righteous, but sinners on to repentance. My Bible let me know that all have sinned and come short of the glory. Somebody ought to get excited up in here. My Bible tells me that my righteousness is as filthy rags in the eyesight of God. Before you start thinking too high of yourself, I'm glad the psalmist said, the wicked are estranged from the womb. They go astray as soon as they are born, speaking lies. What are you saying? That it's a DNA in us that gravitates towards sin. I'm glad that Isaiah said it this way, come now and let us reason together, saith the Lord, though your sins be as scarlet. They shall be as white as snow. They are, though they're red like crimson, they shall be as wool. Somebody ought to be glad that if you hear this gospel, that things can change. That's the reason I am not ashamed of this gospel of Christ, for it is a power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. Why don't you quote that scripture? I think I will. John says that we have access, and that's what I want you to know, that because of this gospel, I have access. But where is it at, Reverend? John 1 and 12. It says, but as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name only. Somebody ought to say access. If you want to get to this gospel, you got to have access, because this gospel will make a difference in your life. I heard somebody say, this gospel will make a player a preacher. This gospel will turn a pimp into a pastor. This gospel will turn a fool into a father. I'm talking about this gospel will turn a hoochie holy. I hope somebody hear me. I'm talking about this gospel, Brianna Bynum. This gospel will make ratchet righteous. Somebody ought to say, this gospel. I'm glad I can get to this gospel. When I was ratchet, this gospel made me righteous. I'm glad. Somebody ought to say, thank you, Lord, because you was ratchet too. Don't act like I'm the only one that was out there. You was ratchet. Or like my grandson say, you is ratchet. There's only two types of folk, those who was and those who is. I'm glad I is a was. Hello, somebody. Or you was a is. This gospel will make a mistress become a mother. This gospel will make a prostitute into a prayer partner. This gospel will make a backstabber a brother. Talking about this gospel. This gospel will turn sinners into saints. This gospel will turn a grave into a gateway. This gospel will turn heaven into my home. Somebody ought to say, this gospel. Not only do I get access in this gospel, but this gospel comes with accountability. All of us want to get in. But you got to get in where you fit in. Yeah. You got to have some accountability. In this gospel, Jesus says, no man, having put his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God. That's accountability. What he's saying is, once you start this, there is no stop. This gospel has some must-dos in it. This gospel has some I must do in it. It ain't I should do, it's some I must do. If you're going to be my disciple, Jesus says there's some must-do. You must deny yourself. Take up your cross and follow him. There's some must-do. There's some accountability into this system. Some of us just want to come to church, and you look good at church, but you're going to hell from church. I refuse to come to church and go to hell. I refuse to come to church and not let God have my life. If I'm not going to change, I wouldn't even come. If I'm not going to give my attitude to God, I'm going to stay outside. Why come in here? Become responsible for something you ain't gonna do. If you still want your cannabis card, you can't have a Christ card. You can't qualify for both of them. And some of us are so bodacious that we declare we sinners and glad about it.
But I want to tell you that this gospel causes you to change. This gospel causes you to change. I know we want another gospel, one that says you can live any kind of way and get to heaven anyway. That gospel is no gospel. That gospel is not the gospel of Jesus Christ. Yes, his grace is sufficient, but you must yield unto his lordship.
Amen.
I'm sorry, and that's the last A, and I'm going to leave y'all alone. Not only is there access in this gospel, not only is there accountability in this gospel, but there's authority in this gospel. Yes, somebody can say amen. Jesus says in Matthew 28 and 18, when Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, All power is given unto me in heaven and in the earth.
Oh, yes.
Acts picks it up in the first chapter, verse 8, and it says, but ye shall receive power. Right. Somebody say, I got power.
I got power.
Some of you won't even say it because you're too mean, because you won't even yield to this gospel. You'll come to church, sit there, act like somebody owed you something, God already paid you. Some of y'all just running around with check stubs. You done spent the money, and all you got is a check stub. But let me tell you about your check stub. The wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life. What you earned, you burned. Amen. But God is saying to us that ye shall have power, and after that the Holy Ghost is coming to you. And you shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem, in all of Judea, in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. My question, how can you declare this gospel and act that way?
Oh! You better come on. Yes, sir.
Right. That's the mirror. That's the mirror. Get out the window. Quit looking at other folk. That's the mirror. How do I declare this gospel and act this way? How do I come to church acting like this and say I'm under this gospel? There's something wrong with it. Because I'm gone in this gospel, I found his birth. Because in this gospel, I found his miracles. Because in this gospel, I found his parables. Because in this gospel, I found his pain. Because in this gospel, I found his sorrow. Because in this gospel, I found his prayer. Because in this gospel, I found his life. Because in this gospel, I found his obedience. I should become obedient. But not only did I find his obedience in this gospel, I found his betrayal.
Oh, yeah.
In this gospel.
Oh, yeah.
I found his trial in this gospel.
Yes, sir.
Here's some more good news. I found his forgiveness. Oh, praise God. In this gospel. Where did you find it? One Friday on a hill called Calvary. I heard him say, Father, in this gospel. Forgive them in this gospel. For they know not what they do. This gospel just fixed it. He said, forgive them. I dare you to tell God, thank you for my forgiveness that I found in this gospel. Not only was there forgiveness in this gospel, I found his death in this gospel. I found his burial in this gospel. But I found Sunday morning, he got up in this gospel. I found there's power in this gospel. I found resurrection in this gospel. Things that were dead are now alive because of this gospel. I was gospel. Once you was a liar, but this gospel, I'm glad of this gospel. I won't preach no other gospel, because I found in this gospel a resting place. I found in this gospel my Lord and my Savior. In this gospel I found out how to be a better father. In this gospel I found how to be a friend. In this gospel I found how to pastor the church. In this gospel I found how to pray. In this gospel I found how to praise God. In this gospel I'm glad. I don't need your help. I got this gospel. And he came to me in this gospel, and he told me, though your sins were scarlet, I have washed them. Do you know you need this gospel? If you're going to make it to heaven, you must come through the gospel. I'm glad I got a gospel. That's why I preach this gospel. I'm going to preach Jesus. When I'm sick, I'm going to preach Jesus. When I'm tired, I'm going to preach Jesus. When you sit down looking at me funny, I'm going to preach Jesus. When you get up, give out the door, I'm going to preach Jesus. When you leave, don't come back no more, I'm going to stand here and I'm going to preach Jesus. I'm glad I don't have nothing. I don't have nothing to tell you except Jesus. When you're angry, Jesus. When you're happy, Jesus. When you say amen, Jesus. When you sit there looking silly, Jesus. When you love me, Jesus. When you allow me, Jesus. When you don't like me, Jesus. When you talk about my children, Jesus. When you talk about my wife, Jesus. When you talk about his church, Jesus. Do you know? Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
Our mission here at the Zion Hill Baptist Church is to prepare God's people to live and love as commanded by the Word of God. Our responsibility is to work until we hear the voice of our Lord say, well done.
We sing that all I need is Jesus, but you don't live like that. First time somebody eat the last chicken wing, we fall out over Stetson hats, chicken wings, smells in the bathroom. We fall out over all kind of stuff. Fall out over people looking at me. They were looking at me, I look back at them. Where was you at? I was in church. Where was you at? I wasn't in church, I was in the Lord's house. There's a certain way I'm not gonna act in the Lord's house. Well, before you clap, don't let me bend the text on you, because you say the earth is the Lord. Yeah. So wherever I'm acting, I'm in his house. However I'm acting, I'm in his vessel, because the Bible said I was bought for a price, that I am not my own anymore. So therefore, I shouldn't just be acting. I should be following the script. Some of you are independent actors. You're off script. And the director showed up this morning to tell you, get back on script, baby. Quit acting that way. That's not who you are anymore. That's not you. You're a different person. You have been changed. How did I change? Because the Bible says, if Christ be in you, you become a new creature. Behold, old things are passed away. Somebody should say, bye-bye. Some of y'all won't even say it, because you content being who you are. You happy who you are. But God is saying, if Christ be in you, because if Christ's not in you, you got a destination with hell. And when the doors are open, you need to come and surrender to Christ to get you out of the crisis, so that you'll be able to do what? Say thank you anyhow. God, thank you that I didn't die with that hell in me.
I pray you are being edified, the lost being evangelized, and that our Jesus is being glorified by our ministry. You are welcome to join us in person. Here is our service information. Zion Hill Baptist Church, 901 Mariposa Street, Rodeo, California, 94572. Phone number 510-799-4647. Website www.march2zion.org. Service times: Sunday school, 9:30 a.m. Sunday worship, 11 a.m. Wednesday Bible study, 7 p.m. Thursday choir worship, 7 p.m. To receive notice of new postings on YouTube, subscribe to our site.